And thank you for the invitation. It's actually my second time here. It's in my constituency, so I could have walked here, but I actually drove by car. So it's my pleasure to be with you. It's not about tourism. I understand that this was the, sort of the main focus, but I've seen also some other talks. So I guess talking about innovation and the German Wesen, we actually had the first version of the talk was the German Angst. But I realized that Angst is too limited. So it's about the German characteristics and innovation. And I hope you enjoy the talk. I hope you can see the slides. Most of them contain images, so that should be okay. But I'll read some of the text to you if you can't see it. So this is my disclaimer. Mark already mentioned the key facts. I'm a member of parliament, conservative member of parliament, newly elected. I'm still saying that I'm from Berlin Mitte. This is here. I've been in the industry. This is an invited talk. I get some money for it, but it's not too much. And these are my personal political views and analysis. This is important if somebody is tweeting or Facebooking or whatever you want. So my topic is innovation from my background in research, in industry, my focus in my committee of research and education. So that's what I want to talk about. And this is there is some negativity in this talk, so I want to say upfront, I love my country, I'm fully supporting my government, so everything which I say critically is meant to be positively in a way to push us forward. But of course, I always start before I come to the critical points with the good points, and innovation is, as you probably would imagine, in very strong hands in Germany. It's a top priority of our chancellor, of my chancellor, of Angela Merkel, not only because she is a physicist herself, but because she knows how important innovation is for our country. Professor Wanka, that is our minister for education and research, she is also a scientist. She is a trained mathematician. She's also from East Germany. So if you would put a third picture in that, you would have three scientists from East Germany working for innovation in this country, but I'm only a small member of parliament, so I'm not as self-confident to put the third picture next to my chancellor and my minister. But it tells you a little story. And this is, this is our Ministry of Education, which is important because Germany is a federal state. We still have Bonn. You wouldn't imagine it, but half of the government, theoretically, at least on paper, is still in Bonn. And this is also true for the Ministry of Research and Education. But if you look at this building, I don't think you would say this is the smaller part of the ministry. And you are right. This is a full house. There would be a space for all of this Ministry for Research and Education. It's just next to Parliament. It's a beautiful building, has been built in time, in plan, without exceeding budget. So this can also happen in Germany. It's really good. But half of the content is still in Bonn, which I would like to change, but it's not so easy in this country. So we have a strong innovation landscape, and this is just a slide for it. We have an excellent strategy. We have excellent a network. People are determined. People are doing good work across the whole country. As I said, we are a federal state. We are establishing clusters not only in the main cities, but all over the country. So actually, we are in good shape. However, and this is my first point, now we come to the German characteristics. This is one of the many obsessions I have. One of the obsessions is, why are we not driving automatic in this country? I'm doing it, but most of my fellow countrymen are still, and I'm looking for the right term, is a drive coupling or transmission driving, whatever, using the clutch. And you know, I'm a great film fan. And I've seen this great movie, Road to Perdition, again. It's a mafia film set in the 1920s and 30s in Chicago area. And there, the father, the main character, played by Tom Hanks, works with his son, who is too young to drive. And he says, do you know where the clutch is or what the clutch is? And then there's a scene on the country road where they actually learn to drive in the 1920s. This is how we learn to drive still in Germany. In almost 100 years later, they are still using the clutch, and the driving teacher in Berlin is still saying, oh, you have to be slowly, carefully working. This is so rubbish. I told my daughter, you won't get a penny for this, so you learn to drive automatic and nothing else. And you can do it in Germany, but it's pretty complicated. You have to sign many forms saying, are you sure that you only want to drive automatic? Because you are not allowed to drive the old-fashioned way. And of course, I'm looking internationally, and if my daughter goes to the US, then nobody would care that she can't drive with old German cars, because in the US they have, I guess since what ages, only the automatic cars. Now, this is my car. I told you I'm not old-fashioned. I'm old-fashioned because I have this little angel in my car, because I'm also superstitious, like most Germans, and I think this is very important. So I always have an angel. It's always a new one. So for each car I'm leasing, there is a new angel with the mandate or the task to protect the car. And then, of course, there's the automatic driving system. And why I'm showing this? Because all the new features, the innovative features, they all depend on automatic. Set speed, automatic lane control, automatic distance control, everything depends on these new systems. And we don't use them in Germany, most of them. I've been driving a car for 4 years from Volkswagen, which had an automatic parking system. I never touched it because nobody showed me, and I just didn't do it. Nobody did it. I used it with my new car, and it's perfect, and I will never go back to the old system, even if they say, well, a true man has to park himself. Well, I don't care. Yeah, I don't care. Yeah, I just let it be done by my car, and it's just perfect. So if we want to go to automatic driving, we have to get rid of the clutch. That's for sure. And Germany is somewhat backward oriented. In this, you may call it traditional, like using cash. Next big political topic. Save the 500 euro note. Well, I never used in my entire life, never used the 500 euro note. It's German tradition. They used to have a 1,000 D-mark note. They've all been very proud of it. Totally useless. Save the 500 euro note. We forced Europe to have a 500 euro note. Now everybody wants to get rid of it. And Germany is defending it like it's, I don't know what. Cash, why want to carry cash and coins? I don't know. We have smartphones, we have all sorts of new devices. It's actually perfect, it's easy. Well, it's more complicated with government. This is a real problem. Our German government system, and especially in the Länder, and worst of all, unfortunately, in my hometown, Berlin, is so backward. You wouldn't believe it. You wouldn't believe it. This is just an image, but it's reality, everyday reality. The e-paper, the e-government, whatever, it's just like some distant planet which they want to reach somewhere in the future. If you talk to startups in this town, we are a startup capital. They say, we work with everybody except public services, because we just can't. Yeah? They are too slow, they are too bureaucratic, they are just too backward. They don't have WLAN, they have nothing. Yeah? And if you ask me, why is that? Well, I don't have an answer. Why are we still using the clutch? I don't know. Why are we still so backward with these things? I don't know. What I do know is that we have some technophobia in this country. These are two of the hot topics. One is called, one is of course, I would say modern plants, but in Germany it was branded as gene technology. Gene technology, of course, somewhat associated with our dark past. Yeah, we have done some terrible crimes, as you know. It has nothing to do with optimizing plants from my point of view, but anyway, this is brand, it's negatively branded. People are believing that that eating these plants would, I don't know, turn them into robots or what have you. So there's a deep-rooted anti-position, whatever, against and against these modern crops. This is on the left side. And of course, the other thing is atomic power. I'm not defending atomic nuclear power, not at all, but I'm just telling that the way the Germans are viewing this topic currently is not based on rational thinking, not on data, not on anything. I mean, we have, as the only country in the world, responded to Fukushima like a scared child, I would say. Totally out of our minds, but it's explainable because we have built up this technophobia, and nuclear power is next to green crops, green modern crops, the evil in itself, so that is German angst. But it's not the only thing, but German angst and technophobia are very, very important, and this leads to German missions. So we have some very strong ideological dogmas in this country, stemming out of these deep-rooted fear beliefs. Yeah. And I'm just giving some examples. We have also have a huge industry of activists who are feeding off this fear, and they have good lives with that, I have to say. I'm open and I accept that they're also doing a good job, but you have to know that they are feeding off this hysteria. So Greenpeace and others are like the force power in this country now. And they're very, very, very powerful, very well connected, very well funded, and this is just one example. It's not all wrong. A lot of these things are actually quite sensible. But if you overdo it, then the results are bad. So I'm all in favor of energy efficiency. I'm all in favor of having intelligent solutions for housing to keep the heat and so forth. But if you do it ideologically, if you set targets which are too difficult to reach, then you are just doing something which is not considering human behavior anymore, which is not considering political sensibility anymore, but is pure ideological dogma. And this happens with housing. We have now a set of regulations which more or less prohibit cheap houses, because there are so many things which need to be and so many targets which have to be met, so many standards which have to be met, it's impossible to build a house in Germany which is affordable. And this is of course a huge topic, because we have so many people in this country who need affordable housing, because of our environmental standards, and because we are saving the world with this, and we are so we also saving each individual. Yeah, of course. I mean, if you can't buy or pay your rent, I think it's more of a disaster for you than some extrapolated climate catastrophe scenarios in the future. But still, that's the way we are selling it to our German people. And I think that is an issue. And this is the worst thing of all. This is the way we are currently handling our energy policy. Germany wants to lead the world. That is the idea. And also, it's not completely nuts. the idea that Germany leads with innovative technologies, and is that's why it's making markets and being upfront with renewable and other technology is not a bad idea. But the way they are handling it, it's totally crazy. The left side of the Bundestag has invented the EEG, it's renewable energy law, and it means literally if you build a wind turbine or a solar panel anywhere in Germany, you have a fixed, you have a guarantee of 20 years being paid for that thing. Whether it needs somebody, whether it's actually working, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. So we have these offshore wind parks. They don't even have, and they're not even plugged to the system, and still people get paid for it because the idea is that anywhere you build a wind turbine, it's good for saving the planet. Anywhere you build a solar panel, it's good for saving the planet. This is totally crazy for me. Yeah, but it's a German reality. It's Planwirtschaft, like the communists did, but without a plan, because they are building the turbines without having the grid to support it. So we have these special situations. Either we have too much wind and sun, then the price of power turns negative, which means that we are giving money to Poland or to to the Czech Republic to take our power, because to keep the grid stable. That is the one scenario. The other scenario is in the winter, we just had it for a couple of weeks, almost no wind and almost no sun. Then we have all this installed power, it's going down like this, and we need nuclear power, coal and gas to keep the system stable, except that they are not running efficiently anymore because in the rest of the year we don't need them. So this tells you a story that this is it sounds crazy, but I can assure you it is also crazy. But unfortunately, it's reality. So I give you some numbers, and I personally feel it's mind-boggling. We are paying investors of wind, solar, and bio, what have you, renewables, 25 billion per year. 25 billion euros per year. Out of my pocket, out of everybody's pocket in this country, out of the pocket of the industry, into the pockets of those investors. As I told you, offshore, some of these turbines are not even plugged to the system, and so forth. Anyway, this is the idea of this law invented by the Red and the Greens some years ago, which we cannot change because we are still buying in the original story. Germany needs to save the world. Germany needs to lead the world. Germany has to be the first. Who, if not Germany, can save the world? This is actually the way we are talking in the Bundestag. These are the total costs. So these are mind-boggling numbers, just added up over a few years. So over a number of years, which is that 2025, you add up to 500 billion euros for the thing. And I just, you know, our little airport problem in Berlin. So I just put up the total costs of the BER, if it ever is finished. I put 8 billion, maybe we should say 10 or maybe 15 billion, but this is total cost. This is not an annual cost. This is total cost of this building of this airport. And so if you compare that to the other numbers, you get a feeling of what we are actually talking about. So I could be done here, but I just give you some more smaller examples. E10, this is one of the ideas. I never put a liter of E10 into any of my tanks, but this was a law we have passed some 5 years ago. So I wasn't member of parliament at that time. The ideas have to have a higher portion of biofuel. Except that it doesn't make sense and nobody is using it. So I put this image, I'm taking the regular one and the E10 is next to it. I don't think anybody is using any of it, but the law is there and we are not able to, we are not honest enough to change it back to normal. So this is this little 10% bioethanol thing, and then e-mobility, my last example. I'm coming from a world where you actually produce something which people want to buy. And if you have a good product, like a good mobile phone or what have you, people are buying it like a sliced bread. Yeah. So, I mean, we never invented a law to force people to buy mobile phones. They just did it because it's a good product. E-mobility has some very strong features. It's not so noisy. It doesn't pollute the air. It's actually without a clutch, just by the way. Yeah. So there are some strong selling points for e-cars. But what are we doing? We are forcing them into the market. We are setting up a law which says we need to sell 1 million vehicles until 2020. This is never going to work. Nobody wants them because there are some unsolved problems, like it takes time to recharge a car, much more time than put some fuel into it. And if you recharge this little vehicle for, 30 minutes, then you can drive some 50 miles, while if you put for 5 minutes fuel into it, you can drive for 500 miles. So you tell me which of the two versions of a car are more attractive to customers. Yeah, this is so fundamental that you wouldn't think that the whole government and the whole German system is still discussing how do we sell 1 million cars to the German people. And I just want to say we need to go back to having good ideas, innovative approaches. I would actually say that the issue here is the service. If you have a package where you have the service of recharging your vehicle by some mechanism, somebody has to do it, but not the customer, then I would guess having a very quiet car without polluting the air is pretty attractive, especially in towns. But if you only think about how many charging stations should be built in Berlin, and what do we do with the other cars, and how do we force people, and how do we tell them that if they are driving the old cars, then they are destroying the planet, while if they drive the new car. So this is not the way you should approach a customer, I think. So e-mobility is a good idea, but not the way we are currently handling it. I think now I've told you enough about our challenges and opportunities in innovation in Germany. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Langsfeld. Excellent presentation. I'm sure you've inspired questions and comments from the audience. As always, we'd like you to please engage. If you could briefly introduce yourself so Mr. Langsfeld knows where you're from, that would be excellent.
Hi, my name is Paolo. I'm from Italy. And you say that you don't know why people still drive car with clutch. You haven't answered. Maybe I have one. It's just funny. I mean, I had the occasion to drive a BMW automatic car. It wasn't funny. I mean, it's just to feel the feeling of the motor and to have, you know, you can decide. I didn't feel neither safe, you know, in an automatic car. I don't know, maybe I'm traditional style. This is my opinion.
I didn't want to attack anybody. I mean, you are a free country. Everybody can drive what he wants. Yeah?
But
at least in my world.
This is one of the reasons.
Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. It was really interesting. Thank you.
You said you were from Italy, right?
Yeah.
So with a Ferrari or a Lamborghini, of course, you can understand you need to have more control. So definitely. But let's continue. I think here. Okay.
Hello, I'm Sophia. I'm from Greece. And you said before that why we use cash and we don't use credit cards or debit cards. My answer is I'm living here for 2 weeks now, and I go to the various shops, and they don't accept credit cards or debit cards. And I think that's a big problem, because when I lived in Belgium for 6 months, everywhere they were accepting cards. So why doesn't the government do
something? It's like the egg and the hen, isn't it? Yeah. They are telling you, oh, customers don't want it. And if you say, I am a customer, then they're telling you, oh, well, but you are the only one. Yeah.
The government has to do something, like oblige the people who have the shops to have that kind of machine and accept cards.
Yeah, that would be one solution, but I'm actually more in favor of let the market, I think we should refocus on having good products and having good, and trying to seduce customers to do, to have an easier life. Yeah. So I think that most people actually, if they have felt the advantages, they would never go back to the old system. But yeah. As long as the companies and shops and so reluctant, then it's difficult. And it's protectionism, I think. I told you I'm leasing cars, and because my wife is a teacher, we had two cars for quite some time. So I went several times to my car dealer to lease a new car. Every time he told me, why are you using an automatic? Why are you not using a diesel? Yeah, I said, I never drove 1 meter with a diesel in my life. I never wanted it. But they were always telling me, but this is and everybody is doing it. And so there's a lot of protectionism also behind this. Yeah, people in this country are so much used to the old ways, they are a little bit afraid of changes. And this is also some deep-rooted fear I told you about. Why have you cash? They said, because the data on the credit card, if somebody is stealing the data, they know everything, yeah? And there is some truth to it, but it's, I would say, balancing it, why? We need better data protection laws for our credit cards rather than keeping the 500 euro note, yeah? But this is really an issue, and there's some the people are helping each other. Yeah? I remember this country has also been having smoking in restaurants much longer than other countries in the world. I've been in the US, nobody would smoke in any hotel. And I had this for 10 years back in Germany. There we had smoking rooms, non-smoking rooms, and they've been smoking in the hotel lobby everywhere. Yeah. So this has changed now, but there's been some very strong resistance saying, well, we always did it, and then the hotels will die down, or the pubs will die down if the people don't smoke in them anymore. If you've been to an old-style German pub, being there 15 minutes, all your clothes would stink for hours, this has been changed, and I think now nobody would say, well, we need to have smoking back in our restaurants, but it takes a while. Yeah.
We have the same problems in Greece.
Yeah.
We have laws, because I'm a lawyer, I know the legal system, but we don't apply the laws. Mm.
That was a good question. Let me throw in a question as well, and I'll give it to my colleague. I think it was interesting dialogue just there in terms of, is it infrastructure? Is it the job of the government to make sure we have the infrastructure there, credit cards, etc.? I would throw a question to you, too. I would, to be provocative, say I think we as human beings have actually much more of an impact and a power than the technology. If you think of sort of lifestyles, for example, every day putting on a suit and a tie and a jacket, getting into an air conditioner car, which parks by itself, or not, going to work, into an air conditioned building, this and that, going to the restaurant and ordering our San Pellegrino water in Germany or our Perrier water in New York, and this and that. And if you just think of the lifestyles, that we have, I think that is actually much more power. So technology is great and enforcement infrastructure is great. But if you think about it, I mean, we as individuals immediately could have, I think, a much bigger impact just in our lifestyles. Strasbourg, Brussels, European Parliament, back and forth, and there's so many inefficiencies that in a second you could actually make big impacts in terms of the environment emissions. Just as a question to you, how much is it technology and innovation? How much is it actually just decisions that we make as human beings about our lifestyles and the way in which we move or don't move, etc.?
It's probably a lot about the individual decisions, but I would put a big question mark. This is the and I thank you too that you support my German colleagues with this question a little bit. I'm not a fan of this ideology saying the worst thing on earth is the human being. And this is this green ideology thinking that you say that the worst polluter on earth is the human being. And you tell every human being have a bad conscience if you walk into your, if you take your car, have a bad conscience if you drink your coffee and so forth. And I'm not a follower of this ideology. And I've been, I'm putting the question provocatively. I've been turning this around. I've never been a great science fiction fan, but if I made, if I meet these climate hysteria, how are they called? In the U.S., how is Ted Cruz in, calling a climate change catastrophe fans, or whatever. I'm looking for the term. Anyway, I've told those people, I remember that in the 60s, we had science fiction novels saying that we are expanding into the whole universe. Yeah, the Earth is just some little station somewhere. Yeah, so why are we now so afraid? Why are we so? Why are we belittling ourselves so much, saying that we cannot find technical solutions which are both good for us and acceptable? In a, of course, it's always a compromise with nature and with Earth. Yeah. So why are we so? And always saying people, oh, you have to have bad feelings if you enter an airplane. You have to have bad feelings if you enter a car. This is the wrong approach. I think the better approach is let's find good solutions. Yeah, if we have polluted cities, if we have noisy cities, let's find smart solutions. If we have too much air traffic, it's too noisy, it's too polluted, let's find smart solutions. Not saying you should not fly, but we should fly better. Not saying you should not drive, but we should drive better, safer. With fun components, okay, but I think safety and comfort is for me much more important than the fun part. Maybe that's because I'm now married and I have two children. That this is for me so much more important. So smart solutions, not saying, oh, we shouldn't do this, that, and the third, because otherwise the planet will go bust.
Okay, just to clarify, my intention was not to sort of, you know, dump on human beings and make them feel bad. I think they're, most scientists I've spoken to, they're not worried about the Earth. The Earth will be fine. We'll have another ice age, this and that. The concern is human beings. Will we survive and will we be able to deal with this?
But so I think that's really the solutions. They want to
right.
Have,
but of course I agree with you. We have to be positive, we have to be constructive, we have to look forward, not to, you know, stop flying. And I think that would bring other problems. But I think, as you said, a combination of the two. And I think I just wanted to make the point. I think we have actually more power as citizens than we think.
Absolutely. But Mark, if you're in Beijing, do you think that the people love to have polluted air every day and traffic jam every day? I don't think so. Yeah, I don't think so. I think they would also look forward to some smart solutions, but they don't want to hear you shouldn't drive or you shouldn't burn coal, because there are some good reasons why China is going the way it's going. But they of course want to have a better air condition, a cleaner air, and they also hate the everyday traffic jam. Yeah. So let's be smart, let's be customer oriented, let's be forward looking. Let's enjoy having a future rather than always saying, oh wow, it's 5 minutes to 12. How many times do I heard this? Since decades, every other 5 years I hear it is 5 minutes to 12. Always 5 minutes to 12. I think this clock must have been stuck. Yeah. At 5 minutes to 12, since World War II, I guess. Yeah.
Two more comments, then we have to bring it to a conclusion.
Thanks for your presentation. My name is Esteban. Thanks for your presentation. My name is Esteban. I'm from Barcelona, Spain. I want to make briefly comments and after a question. It's funny though what you are talking about the debate between the credit cards and cash. For example, here is the problem that you are not German or living in Germany and you don't have an Exacard, you have a lot of problems to pay with credit card in some places. The other thing is, like, for example, I was living in Finland and you can pay even a chewing gum with credit card. Everything, you can pay everything. The other thing is, like, you mentioned the 500 euros note. They are planning to take it away in order to avoid the black money. One is just maybe the opposite. It's easier to pay with black money with the small bills because nobody suspects about that the big ones. So, and the other thing, that the fun part that you mentioned, it reminds me a little bit an interview with the great Niki Lauda. he was a great Formula One pilot, and after the accident, he say, for me, it's not just to have fun anymore, it's to be cautious. So even, sometimes even, and he was a big expert under the rain, he just quit the race because, no, I can do it, there is no problem, but I have a wife that I love. And after that accident, I had more caution. I suggest you to watch the movie Rush. By the way, there is a Berliner, Barcelona, a great actor there, that is Daniel Brühl. The other question is regarding that we were talking about cars and advanced technology. What do you think has to happen to change, the power units? Because a few weeks ago in Harvard University, some people discovered something that it was unbelievable. Everybody knows hydrogen. Hydrogen is a gas. Some people were able to convert that gas in a solid metal. And they discovered just with a very small portion, it has a very long life, and it was really very powerful. So, but after, suspectly, that the discovery disappeared, and the fundings of the resource were cut. Of course, there is a big interest of the gas and petrol companies to keep the business going on. But what do you think has to happen in order to move forward to use that new technologies that they are cleaner than what we have now?
Yeah, thank you. And I would repeat that point. I think if we have customer-oriented good solutions, good products, they are selling themselves. We don't have to force e-mobility into the market if we have a good product. So customer orientation, smart solutions, true innovation sells itself. That's my belief. Maybe not always. Maybe there's always a little help. And we are. I told you we are investing so much into research and innovation that is subsidies, and they are perfectly justified. But in the end, it has to be the market. It has to be the people who want to buy these things. And as I told you, all these mobile phone generations. We've been talking about the same climate catastrophe. Why we have been. Having 7 or 8 generations of smart devices selling themselves like crazy. Yeah. So be more customer oriented. And this is a big problem in our country, that we don't feel easy with being serviced. If you compare that to the US, in a hotel, there are 10 people who want to help you with luggage, with all things. If you compare that to the German hotel, you will have one person saying, please sign this form, and then the rest you do yourself. That's a cultural thing, and I think we will need to change that. We need to have somebody service our e-cars. That is my true belief. Otherwise, this will never fly, because I don't have the time to wait for half an hour or what have you until this bloody car is recharged. Yeah. And nobody else has that either. And I'm living in a flat in Berlin, so I don't have a place to charge it overnight. So if we are not service oriented, these types of solutions will not work. And that is a different mindset. Go away from government enforced solutions back to our true strengths, which is a free market. And then innovation and good products will succeed. Thank you.
Yeah. Yes, I'm Katrine from Norway. Mm-hmm. I'm very surprised to learn how underdeveloped you are with the e-solutions, especially in the public sector. But on the upside, at least you're keeping people employed.
That's the idea.
I don't, because you have to go to an office for everything that at home we just do online. We register everything online with our e-identities. Anyway, but my question was about you were talking about how you were so quick to adhere to like new things, the new goals, like e-mobility and renewable energy, mm-hmm. and you set high goals. And I was wondering how much of those things are coming out of EU coming from Brussels, or how much is coming from
Germany?
We are
pushing this on Brussels.
Oh, so you to blame, because
if you want to put that word, I didn't say that, but yes, we are setting like CO2 reduction goals. Germany has individual goals which are twice as high as those of the EU. Yeah, so this is the way we are exporting. Germany is exporting these things to Brussels rather than the other way around.
Okay, because Norway is so quick to jump to the things coming out from Brussels. We're not even a member, but now I know who to blame.
I wouldn't say. I always tell my team, I don't want to hear who is to blame. I want to hear solutions. I never look back, look forward. And that's why I said in the beginning, I love my country, so I don't want you to take away that Germany is stupid and doesn't know what it's doing. We are having our little weaknesses, and we have done mistakes. But looking forward, I'm still very confident that we can find good solutions for our country, also for Europe. So, but yes, the ideology is a big problem, and it's not an invention of Brussels itself, but a mindset which comes strongly out of Germany, of course, out of other countries too. Yeah, so we are not the only ones going. You will find in every country this left-green type of ideology, but Germany is the strongest partner in this campaign. Yes.
Well, you're not alone.
Yeah. Thanks.
Well, on that note, let's express our sincere gratitude.
Thank you.